Hey, hello, and welcome to another online interview from SalesPOP Online Sales Magazine. My name is John Golden from SalesPOP and Pipeliner CRM, and today I am joined by Kenton Lee, who is in Idaho today. How are you doing, Kenton?
I am doing great. Great to have a chance to chat with you, John. Thank you.
Yes, so Kenton started this business a number of years ago, The Shoe That Grows, and I really, really encourage you to go look at it because it's quite an amazing piece of technology, but a shoe that grows with the child's foot. And it was an idea to address some of the issues around poverty. And this is kind of your passion, Kenton. So could you just tell us a little bit about that, and then we'll get into what you really, your core message today, which is really about the power of small things.
Yeah, sure. So really, this has been kind of an unexpected journey in my life. But I, right after college, I lived internationally for about a year. And I found myself living at a small orphanage in Kenya. And when I was there, I grew up in the United States. I never really saw extreme poverty before. So one day, as I was with the kids, there was this little girl next to me. I'll never forget. She had on a white dress, and we were walking, and I looked down, and her shoes were way too small for her feet. They were so small, she had to cut open the front to let her toes stick out. And that day, I just had a small idea of, what if there was a pair of shoes that could adjust and expand their size? What if there was a pair of shoes that could grow? It seemed like it would make sense for this little girl and other kids at the orphanage who, they had growing feet, which obviously kids do. But they didn't have any other options for shoes. They couldn't afford to buy new shoes or get donated shoes. That just wasn't an option. So I just thought, what if there was a shoe that could grow? And that led me into a six-year kind of design journey, just something I did on the side. It was my passion. It was my hobby. Finally was able to make a first batch of about 3,000 pairs of our growing shoes called The Shoe That Grows. It can grow five sizes. It can last for years. And then we accidentally went viral about 3.5 years ago. And so now we have a full team of people that are working on this every day. We've gotten over 180,000 pairs of The Shoe That Grows to kids in over 100 countries. We're just getting started with some of the great ways we can use this small idea to make an impact even beyond just getting kids shoes. But it all started with, kind of this unexpected idea that popped into my head when I was traveling.
So it kind of, and I think this is the message we want to talk about. It really started with you looking at something, not small so much, but something, you know, looking at a solution to a particular problem, something that you felt that you could do something about, as opposed to, okay, you could have looked at that little girl's feet and then you could have looked at the wider issue and said, oh my goodness, this is generational poverty, it's structural poverty, it's all of these other things, right? And you could have said, oh, I'm going to try and fix all of this, and probably, no offense, but probably not really made a dent in it if you went to try and tackle the overall problem, right?
Yeah, totally. So in many, many ways, I am just a regular guy. I'm from a small town here in Idaho, which not a lot of people know where Idaho is in the U.S., and so for me, as I was traveling around the world and kind of being overwhelmed by so many issues that I was seeing, because I knew it wasn't just as simple as, you know, hey, if we fix this, then everything's fine. You know, like you said, it's generational, it's large structures. It's for so many reasons we have poverty, and poverty affects people in lots of ways. But for some reason, when I saw that little girl and those shoes that were just way too small, and I had an idea that I thought could be a decent solution, I kind of just latched onto it. And I thought, you know, I know a growing shoe that could grow five sizes and last for years, it's not going to solve every problem for this little girl. It's not going to solve every problem for these kids, but it is a small thing that could make a big difference.
Right.
And that was really one of the phrases that I kind of latched onto about 10 years ago. And I've had it kind of as a mantra ever since. I really believe in the power of small things, because I believe small things really do make a big difference. Mm-hmm. You know, it might not be the silver bullet solution that solves every problem, but even if it helps one person, even if it helps your neighborhood, even if it helps in a small way to alleviate suffering or just make something easier and better, those things add up. And if a lot of regular people like me and others out there, if we can, maybe we don't have the power like Bill Gates mm-hmm. to do large things, giant things, and make huge systemic changes. But for regular people, I think we can just do small things, and that still makes a big difference.
Yeah, and I couldn't agree more, because I think it's often, in some ways, it's often easier to sit around and talk about large issues, which in reality you can't impact, but you can certainly talk about them, you can opine on them, etc. And even within companies, right, you can talk about the overall strategy of the company or whatever, and you can, again, you know, you can opine and whatever. But if you really pull it, and that's an easy thing to do, because in some ways that's a get out of jail free card, because you can't really impact these macro things, right? So if you were to pull it back and look at, okay, what are the things in front of me that I could impact, then that's where you can take action, and that's where you can really make a difference, right?
Totally. And even in a business way, mm-hmm. so as I kind of had that mantra in my mind and in my heart of, you know, there's power in small things make a big difference. It's not just in helping people or trying to make a difference in someone's life. I have seen so many times in our business that I have done a small thing, whether it's a thank you note or, you know, making that extra phone call, sending that email back, you know, right when I get it, you know, kind of smaller things that have yielded great results for us. And I really am just a believer in so many areas of life and work that small things really do make a big difference. If you want to make that, you know, big sale to, you know, those five clients that you're working with in your pipeline, well, maybe instead of just focusing on, you know, the sales pitch or whatever, you know, what are some small things? What are some of the details that go into that, that really those small details could make the biggest impact on them? And so for us as a small business in Idaho, none of us, anyone on my team, you know, we don't have a ton of money or anything like that. So for us, we've had to rely on hustling mm-hmm. and just trying to outwork and outsmart, you know, other groups and trying to do whatever we can to make things happen. And a lot of that has to do with, we kind of do a lot of small things and try to do them really well. So in many areas, I'm just such a big believer in the power of small things.
Yeah, and I think that's one of the things that anybody listening today could probably look around themselves in their personal life or in their professional life and probably identify a bunch of small things that they could do. And it's really kind of breaking a habit, isn't it, in many ways, rather than always fixating on the large problem or thinking that big is the only thing that matters.
Exactly. And even for me, this is a great interview. You're asking great questions. Sometimes when I'm interviewed, people will just go right to the end result. You know, they'll look at me now and say, wow, you created this shoe, you've got a great team, you've got a great business, you're just living your dreams. And I try to take a step back and remind them, like, it took me 6 years to make the design for the shoe. And then it's taken, you know, an additional 4 years to grow our business to where it is today. Like, that doesn't happen mm-hmm. overnight. You know, it's a lot of hard work. It's a lot of small things mm-hmm. that can build to help you get to where you want to go. So I think for people who just look at where they are today and where they want to be, it can either be so overwhelming, or they can just get very idealistic or kind of pie in the sky. Mm-hmm. And really what matters is just that next step. Yeah. You know, what's that next step to get you on that path to where you want to go? And so even with our shoes, for us, we feel like these kids are so awesome that we work with. We're so excited to be a small part in their life, but we hope to be a small thing that can put them in a better spot to succeed. You know, just one step in their journey that helps them be able to attend school more often, and stay more healthy and just be more confident so that they can go on and, you know, complete their education, find that great job, you know, raise a great family, be a part of a great community. And if our shoes can be a small part of that, like that's what we're trying to do. We're so happy to put time and energy and passion into trying to put these kids in a position to succeed. And if we can use a shoe to do that, we're happy to try to do that. Yeah.
And maybe even that they get inspired by the shoe itself and even by the history behind the shoe, because for them, if you think about it, and for a lot of people, as we said at the beginning, issues can seem, you know, circumstances can seem like they're insurmountable or the whole world is kind of aligned against you, if you like. So maybe even your shoe is a, can it inspire those people to think, oh, look, well, somebody could come up with a solution, you know, for my shoe, then maybe I can come up with a solution for maybe the first obstacle, the next obstacle, or some obstacle that's in front of me.
Yeah, exactly. And actually, one of the great things that has come out of the shoe that grows, as our business has expanded, we have a new program called Pursuit, which is basically, we believe there are more good ideas out there for great products that can help kids and families and, you know, kind of small things that can make a big difference. And we don't think we're the ones who are going to come up with the next great idea necessarily. But for those who do, especially if it's that kid who just got inspired or someone living in a small village and they've been really resourceful, they maybe been using a hack that has just been awesome for like years and years. Like for anyone who has a great idea but just needs a little bit of help to go from idea to reality, we want to come alongside them and help them pursue that idea, because we just really believe that the positive cycle of innovation can fight the negative cycle of poverty. So if our shoes can be a little inspiration for that, and then if we can come alongside people and basically say, hey, you provide the idea, we're going to give you the tools and the education and the funding to help make this happen. We're so excited to see where our business can grow into the future. And essentially, our mission is to use innovation to try to make things better.
Yeah, no, I love that idea of like going and trying to get ideas from, because as you say, you know, there's when you crowdsource, if you like, ideas, you're going to get, and you're getting ideas from the people who actually the issue impacts, as opposed to maybe, you know, somebody on the outside saying, I think I have a solution for you. It's, you know, hopefully more of those come from the people who know the reality on the ground. No pun intended with your shoes.
No, but that's so true. Like for me, I would have never known about this issue for kids, or maybe I could have read about it in a book or seen it on a video, but when I lived there at that orphanage for several months, I got to see it firsthand, and I got to see what a big difference a good pair of shoes can make for a kid. And so now that I live back here in the States, in Idaho, you know, I'm not going to have the next great idea to help find a solution for someone in, you know, South America, Central America, Africa. And that's why we're excited to connect with those who are living in those situations, who live it every day and know the challenges and hopefully would have a great solution. We're just excited to come alongside them and help make that happen.
And that's the important thing, I think, is that you figured out, you know, with the shoe that grows, you figured out how to make these ideas happen. So let me just take you back for a moment to the start. So when you came back and, you know, you had this idea and you decided to go, what were some of the initial lessons that you learned, or some of the things that, you know, obstacles that you had to overcome that were surprising to you?
Yeah, so right when I got back home and I had this idea and wanted to explore it, I didn't know a thing about shoes. I had no experience in the shoe industry, really not an engineering kind of guy either. This was like the one idea I've ever had. But so the first thing I did, I grabbed a few friends and then we tried to essentially give the idea away to a shoe company. We contacted all the major shoe companies, Nike, Reebok, Adidas, everybody, and basically tried to just give it away. We wanted someone to do it. We didn't care who did it. We just wanted someone to do it. And everybody said no. A lot of them said, you know, not a good idea. This is never going to work, stuff like that. And it was probably a year. So I was kind of doing this on the side. So it was kind of a year of rejection, basically, and people saying like, yeah, it's not going to work. This isn't a good idea. But I kept on going, mostly because I had been there. Like, I was at the orphanage. I saw it firsthand. Nobody could tell me this was a bad idea because I saw it and I knew it was a good idea. It was just a matter of trying to find the right way to make it work. And so one of the biggest lessons I learned was kind of the phrase, if at first you don't succeed, try again, you know, like, so, okay, that the shoe companies didn't want to help us. So then I tried to make a prototype in the garage by myself. That did not work at all. I didn't know what I was doing. So the big guys didn't want to help us. I couldn't do it myself. We finally found a really small shoe development company that loved what we were trying to do and helped us out. And it took a while to kind of network to be able to find them. But once we found them, that helped us get to our next stage. Once we got there, you know, it just kind of was kind of a one step at a time. And again, it took 6 years. And so it was a big journey. It wasn't like I was, you know, paying myself or anything. It was just kind of a nights and weekends kind of a thing. But looking back, it was kind of fun, you know, like I was passionate about it. And I really learned that people respond to your passion. You know, if you've got a great idea for something, you might not have a prototype, you might not have the business plan, you might not have anything figured out. But if you work hard and hustle, and if you can get in front of people and just share your passion, sometimes that's all you need to get started. That's all I had. And so I encourage anyone out there, if at first you don't succeed, try again, and just keep letting your passion be your guide.
Yeah, and I think that's a great lesson. As I said, you know, there's a lot of people who watch this channel who are salespeople, and I think that's a huge reminder to them is whatever product or service or whatever you're selling is, you have to have passion for it, and you have to be able to communicate the passion. And sometimes, you know, that, as you say, will make all the difference, especially if you're up against a bunch of other people. You know, your passion may shine through. So the other part there is the perseverance. Obviously, that took a tremendous amount of perseverance with people telling you that you couldn't do it. And I'm sure there were people in your wider circles who were like, well, what's Kenton up with this shoe in the garage and all that? So when you had moments, and I'm sure you did, when you had moments and you thought, okay, this is never going to happen, how did you put that aside and just keep going?
Yeah, that's a great question. I definitely had those moments and wanted to give up, you know, thought maybe this isn't worth the time and the effort and the money that I was putting into it. But I really tried to, I guess, kind of own those feelings. Mm-hmm. I didn't want to run away from those feelings and pretend they weren't there. But I kind of just would give myself a little bit of time to be sad or to be frustrated or depressed. And, you know, I'd eat a little ice cream and then I'd say, okay, you know, time's up. I got to keep going. But the other really helpful thing, so in the midst of a lot of people, kind of external people, the shoe companies and others, and even internal people, friends and people who just didn't quite understand what I was doing, in the midst of some rejection and obstacles there, I also had a lot of people in my life who were encouraging me and were cheering me on. And that really meant so much to me, even if they didn't understand really what I was doing. You know, they just believed in me. They saw that I was passionate about something. They would always ask me about it. You know, they'd always want an update. You know, what's happening? How can I help? And to have those people in my life, it's been really fun now to be able to, you know, send them notes, or if we get, you know, an article or an award or something, you know, be able to send that to them and say, hey, thanks for believing in me when nobody else really did. And so for anybody, if all you have are negative people in your life, you know, try not to listen to them, but also go find some positive people. You know, I mean, go, you know, for me, it was, I joined a Rotary Club. Right. My Rotary Club was so supportive. You know, my friends and family, I really let them into what I was doing. I shared with them about my hopes and dreams, and they were excited to support it. So if you feel like you've got nobody on your team, you know, go find someone to be on your team.
I think that's a hugely powerful message there, Kenton, because I do think that sometimes people allow negative influences to exist in their lives for far too long and to play a far too big a role. And I think that's a great, even if it means that for a time you have to remove everybody from your life and go find, as you say, find some positive influences. But if you continue to surround yourself by positive influences and you listen to them, obviously it's going to have an impact. And the other piece you just said there about owning that feeling when you're down or when things aren't going well for you, owning it, knowing what it is and moving beyond it. I think those are very powerful, powerful statements.
Well, it really helped me to know that, you know, yeah, like I took a swing and I missed, you know, I struck out and I don't feel good about that, but I'm not going to bury it deep inside and then maybe kind of like burn out completely, you know, but no, I'm going to take my hits. I'm going to keep on going. I'm going to have a sad night, but in the morning, I'm going to get up and make some more calls, you know? So that worked for me. I don't know what it is for other people, but that, and it was almost, this is a small story, but really I kind of did use, for a while it was ice cream and then it was movies. Mm-hmm. I would kind of tell myself like, okay, if this doesn't go well today, you know, with these 10 phone calls or whatever it might be with this meeting, if it goes bad and they don't want to be a part of what I'm doing, then I'm going to go watch a movie tonight. And I would kind of get excited about that. I love to watch movies. So it was kind of almost a win-win. Either I'm going to get a yes from somebody and I'll be happy about that, or I'm going to go watch a movie and I'll be happy about that. So kind of, you know, putting yourself, especially in sales, putting yourself in a position where, you know, you're not completely devastated. At least there's something to look forward to a little bit. I don't know. That worked for me. That might not be good advice at all, but that helped me.
No, I think anything that helps you get into the right frame of mind to get back on the horse, if you like, I think is a good thing. Okay, so we're up against the end of our time here. Kenton, before we go, could you just tell people a little bit more about yourself and your organization, how they can find out more?
Yes. If anyone would like to be a part of what we're doing with The Shoe That Grows, we would love for you to go to our website. It's simply theshoethatgrows.org. And there, when you're at the website, you can find lots of different ways to be involved. A couple of the main ones, obviously, we love any sponsorship of shoes to go to these awesome kids. So for $15, you could sponsor a pair of shoes to go to a kid. Or maybe you work with kids. Maybe you work with kids around the world in an organization or your church, and you know kids who could benefit from a growing shoe, and you've seen that. We would love to talk to you about trying to take some shoes with you, or having your organization or your church take some shoes with them as they travel and work with those kids. We have a lot of different partners who take shoes and get them to the right kids. And if you just want to connect with me, I love talking to people. My email, my cell phone are all listed on our website. Would love for you to get in touch with me and talk about any way that you'd like to be involved, or even just kind of connect personally as well. But all of that can happen at theshoethatgrows.org.
Excellent. Thank you, Kenton. And one last quick question. Did you ever get a pair of your shoes onto the feet of the little girl that you met at the orphanage?
That's a great question. She got one of our first pairs. So we took some prototype pairs. My wife and I went back to Kenya, put them in four different schools, and that orphanage was one of the kind of orphanage and schools, and so it was really fulfilling and surreal to, you know, 6 years later, mm-hmm. take a pair of shoes. She wasn't a little girl anymore, she was about 15, but to take those shoes back to the orphanage, and she got to wear one of our first pairs. That was one of the highlights of my life, yeah.
Excellent. Thanks, Kenton. That's really inspiring. My name is John Golden, SalesPOP Online Sales Magazine, Pipeliner CRM. Thank you again, Kenton. Make sure you go check out The Shoe That Grows, and I'd encourage you to get involved. This is such an awesome endeavor.
Well, thanks so much, John. Appreciate it.
So I encourage you to subscribe to salespop.net, the online sales magazine. Also subscribe to our YouTube channel, and then comment. Get involved in the conversation. Love to hear what you have to say.